Jodi Gilbert, she's just a minor Hollywood character actress, spars with W.C. Fields in Never Give a Sucker and Even Break like a complete pro. She's just breathtaking.
You're as funny as a cry for help.
All the great movie waitresses like Joan Blondell and Joan Crawford were tremendously inspiring to me, because then I could just be a tough-talking, hard-boiled waitress. And at the end of the day, I'd take my apron off and go home and be an artist instead. I knew there was a story in it because there were so many compelling characters. I would recommend absolutely studying film, because there's no better visual medium for storytelling than the movies. I'm Mimi Pond, and the movies made me do it.
The TCM Shop is the ultimate source for the best in classics on DVD and Blu-ray. And now is the perfect time to build your home movie library with our wonderfully curated releases and beloved films from over 50 different studios. Doris Day tries to convince husband Rex Harrison that she's being stalked in Midnight Lace. Then wife Greer Garson struggles after husband Ronald Coleman loses his memory in Random Harvest. And substitute teacher Sidney Poitier refuses to have his spirit broken in To Sir With Love. So visit shop.tcm.com and find comfort in the classics. From legendary movies on DVD and Blu-ray, to books curated by TCM, nostalgic puzzles and games, even movie-inspired music and soundtracks, plus so much more. The TCM Shop. Bring home the classics.
She seems weary. Fleury goes to the other extreme. He overdoes it. He declaims instead of speaking. And he doesn't make love to Juliet. He makes love to the audience.
That's enough, my son. To criticize is easy. To be better or not to be, that's a question for actors. So suppose you show the class. Go on up. Begin with the line, he jests at scars that never felt a wound.
He jests at scars that never felt a wound.
Take a deeper dive into the world of movies and culture. Subscribe to TCM's YouTube channel. Subscribe today at youtube.com/Turner Classic Movies to keep up with new videos and special events.
My name is Mimi Pond, and I'm a cartoonist. I'd watch old Busby Berkeley musicals, and there were all these little bars that lined the main street of our neighborhood, And I just imagined that each of those tiny bars inside expanded and there was a dance floor and a big band. And I was like, oh, if only I could go in there. I got out of school and I needed a job, so I went to work as a waitress. I decided to see it as a role I was playing. And Jody Gilbert, she's just a minor Hollywood character actress, spars with W.C. Fields in Never Give a Sucker and Even Break like a complete pro. She's just breathtaking.
You're as funny as a cry for help.
All the great movie waitresses like Joan Blondell and Joan Crawford were tremendously inspiring to me, because then I could just be a tough-talking, hard-boiled waitress. And at the end of the day, I'd take my apron off and go home and be an artist instead. I knew there was a story in it because there were so many compelling characters. I would recommend absolutely studying film, because there's no better visual medium for storytelling than the movies. I'm Mimi Pond, and the movies made me do it.
From 1931 to 1955, moviegoers were treated to beautiful travel shorts that appeared just before the main feature.
Copenhagen has a population of about 900,000 inhabitants, and it is estimated that there is one bicycle registered for every three persons.
Created by New York filmmaker James A. Fitzpatrick, Travel Talks gave audiences a glimpse into countries most would never get to see in person.
After a three-hour climb, we behold Machu Picchu, the deserted Inca city.
Producing over 200 shorts in 25 years, Fitzpatrick logged 500,000 miles and frequently appeared on screen. James Anthony Fitzpatrick grew up in New York City and attended the American Academy of Dramatic Arts. But when his acting career stalled, he moved behind the camera. For years, Fitzpatrick made a variety of short films. Then at 35, found his life's work, the travelogue.
Volendam, a small fishing village on the shores of...
Distributed under Fitzpatrick Travel Talks by MGM, 1934's Holland in Tulip Time was shot in the new three-strip Technicolor process, bringing the action to vivid life. Travel Talks grew in popularity. Since overseas travel was difficult in an era that saw a Great Depression and a world war, Fitzpatrick traveled 9 months out of the year, a commitment to his work that brought his audiences rare dramatic footage.
And today on the plantation,
like the sun worship ritual of the Incas,
colorful scenes are reenacted by the native Indians,
South Africa's Zulu tribe, and encounters with indigenous cultures closer to home, such as the Sioux Indian sun dance and the Hawaiian hula.
Hulas of courtship and love, hulas of birth.
At a time when actual travel was largely limited to those with means, everyday moviegoers were treated to panoramic vistas of far-flung locations, all from the comfort of their theater seats. For the price of a movie ticket, Travel Talks brought audiences thrilling new perspectives on world wonders, natural, man-made,
the longest single-span bridge in the world,
and somewhere in between.
This great sculpture is credited to Doan Robinson, and the execution of the idea is in the hands of Gutzon Borglum, one of the world's foremost sculptors. Our ship has now become a floating hull.
His practice of narrating the films himself allowed him to treat his audience as a travel companion, seeing the country together for the first time.
Who spoke with a Scottish accent so thick that we had difficulty in understanding him.
The result was a paradox that worked. Viewers saw the wide world on a big screen in glorious Technicolor, but in a way that was nevertheless intimate. This approach, along with the sheer volume of films he produced, earned Fitzpatrick his reputation as the voice of the globe. The vignettes were not merely pretty pictures strung together. They routinely touched on the architecture, religion, culture, and history of the places he visited. His scripts suggest Fitzpatrick was a curious man, able to step outside his roots. By focusing on the remarkable, the enduring, and the great achievements of humankind, Fitzpatrick's work remains evergreen and still inspires that wistful longing for adventure.
In San Jose, our plane is waiting to transport us to our northern homes, 3,000 miles away. Today could mean a complete swing around the world.
Welcome to the next great way to experience TCM, the digital Now Playing newsletter, a comprehensive guide to everything TCM. It starts with our programming schedule, an alphabetical guide packed with hundreds of your favorite classic movies playing this month on TCM. Looking for a quicker way to find out what you want to watch? Then check the monthly highlights calendar, our printable schedule highlighting primetime films, daytime themes, TCM premieres, live tweets, and more. This free newsletter will be emailed directly to your inbox twice a month, and it includes exclusive videos, rarely seen photos, links to in-depth articles, biographies, a variety of games, trivia, and the TCM crossword puzzle. You'll also receive the most up-to-date information on big screen classics, backlot events, as well as discounts at the TCM shop. The Digital Now Playing newsletter. Stay connected like never before. Sign up for free by visiting tcm.com. Now Playing email.
Looking to jazz up movie night? The TCM Wine Club hits all the right notes. Enjoy premium wines from around the world delivered straight to your door. From Eartha Kitt to a trip to the moon, the TCM Wine Club takes you on a voyage of discovery, sourcing spectacular domestic and international wines. Every case is expertly curated with informative tasting notes and recommended pairings with great classic movies seen on TCM. As part of a special welcome offer, you'll receive 15 delicious wines, including 3 exclusive movie-themed wines for an incredible value. Your satisfaction is guaranteed. Now celebrating its 5th anniversary, the TCM Wine Club delivers memorable sips and swing to your movie routine. Visit tcmwineclub.com or call 1-844-WINE-TCM.
Thank you. Charles Foster Kane.
You just want to persuade people that you love them so much that they ought to love you back.
Don't miss the 80th anniversary of Citizen Kane returning to cinemas for a limited engagement.
Rosebud.
Featuring exclusive insights from Ben Mankiewicz. For more information, go to fathomevents.com.
And this year's Academy Award winner, Grace Kelly. Two exciting personalities who were made for each other. And now Alfred Hitchcock brings them into very close contact in this perfect tale of romantic intrigue, filmed on the beautiful French Riviera.
You have a very strong grip, the kind a burglar needs.
That's why you came out here, isn't it?
The scandalous romance that shocked even the blasé international set between this restless, thrill-hunting American heiress and the notorious man of mystery the French underworld called the Cat. For the game they played was not played for money, and the characters they played with played for keeps. No one but Hitchcock could create such relentless excitement, filling the screen with fireworks as he matches the blazing talents of these two great stars in the love affair of the year.
Look, John. Hold them. Diamonds. Have you ever had a better offer in your whole life? One with everything.
TCM presents Classic Travel, the 20th Century Limited. In North by Northwest, director Alfred Hitchcock employs nearly every form of mechanical transportation, from planes to automobiles. But by far the most stylish mode of travel in the movie is the train.
You want me to jump off a moving plane?
On the run in the film, Cary Grant boards the 20th Century Limited. But what was the 20th Century Limited? Until the dawn of the jet age, the most glamorous way to travel was by train. And no train was more luxurious or modern than the 20th Century Limited. The term red carpet treatment came from the carpet passengers used to walk on the platform. The Limited left Grand Central Terminal in Manhattan at 6 p.m. and arrived a brisk 16 hours later at Chicago's LaSalle Street station.
What have you got in these bags?
Bowling balls, naturally.
The engines were models of Art Deco modernity, created by legendary designer Henry Dreyfuss, who also created the Western Electric Model 500 telephone. The Pullman cars embodied mid-century sophistication, simple and understated, with fold-out beds.
Tell me, why are you so good to me?
And small powder rooms suitable for freshening up or just getting fresh. The 20th Century Limited ceased its service in 1967 as train travel gave way to air travel. However, in recent years, Amtrak has offered the Lakeshore Limited from Penn Station to Union Station for people who still wanted a taste of old school glamour. And that's Classic Travel, brought to you by TCM.
You just want to persuade people that you love them so much that they ought to love you back.
Don't miss the 80th anniversary of Citizen Kane returning to cinemas for a limited engagement.
Rosebud.
Featuring exclusive insights from Ben Mankiewicz. For more information, go to fathomevents.com.
There were usually brilliant performances in a Kazan movie, and then every once in a while, just on the fringes of the story, little characters would come in, and I wondered why that was. So I went around to some of the actors who had worked with Kazan and asked them, well, how does Kazan work? Well, Gadge was his nickname. Gadge will always be watching you when you're least aware that anyone is watching you. If he finds a particular idiosyncrasy that you may have, either a gesture or the way of looking at something or the way, he will find a way to use that in the character. There was a particular time in Piggott, and we were out in the dusty field, and I was up on a stage, and I was with Lonesome Rose and Andy Griffith, and I was watching, and I was the publicity guy, and Lee Remick was down there doing twirling her baton. And Gadge is walking away, and I see him looking at me, just fanning myself, and I hear Gadge say, okay, bring the camera back, Tony, stay right there. So the camera was brought back, and he said, just do what you're doing. Just relax and just fan yourself. So I did that, and he said, now look over where Lonesome Rhodes is. And I look over there. He said, now look over to where Lee is. And I looked over there, and he said, now think about the fact that maybe they can get together. So I said, uh-huh. So that was a scene that in which I felt that I used Gadge's observation as a director, and it worked. It worked very well. It was used in the film.
When we're together, it just feels like we're part of something. I love working with these guys. The idea now that there's five of us, I think the spirit of classic films, the future of classic films is in good hands. I think Robert Osborne would approve, I really do.
Been going around with a fellow a reasonable length of time, supposed to go to bed with him or not?
What kind of a question is that to ask?
Well, it keeps coming up all the time.
If you've got troubles, just take them out for a walk. They'll burst like bubbles in the fun of a Sunday in New York.
What are you doing in New York?
Oh, I usually come to New York on Sundays if I can. I like New York.
And ride on the Fifth Avenue bus.
True love never runs smoothly. Boy meets girl, they become very much attached to each other. Boy loses girl. Then boy gets girl back, and they live happily ever after.
In movies, this is where the screen usually goes dark.
But when it happens on Sunday in New York, that's different. First, boy meets girl's brother.
Look, we just got caught in the rain.
The simple truth is, Adam, I tried to get him to seduce me, and he wouldn't do it. And that is exactly what happened. He wouldn't have anything to do with a beginner.
Then boy meets girl's lover.
Oh, I'm crazy about you, you little monkey.
Then delirium takes over.
That's good. It'll give us time to think of a story. Now you just get upstairs and put your clothes on.
Jane Fonda is delightfully daffy as the uneasy doll who keeps a bevy of baffled males on edge for an entire Sunday in New York. Rod Taylor is the eager Lothario.
Now what are you thinking?
That I changed my mind about us and my chances about five times, and the last time I would have bet my life on it.
Lucky you didn't, you'd have lost.
Cliff Robertson is the high-flying big brother.
Stop that plane!
His love life is in a tailspin of its own.
Where are we going?
Oh, we're going to Denver.
Denver? What for?
I'm flying the plane. We'll be together. I got the ticket.
Oh, no.
It could only happen in Sunday in New York. It's touch and go, in and out of clothes, and embarrassing situations.
Was my sister in a robe?
Will you get your mind out of the gutter?
The uproarious adventures and madcap escapades of a kooky heroine and her wild and wonderful partners in confusion.
there's a question of whether one who wants to sing and act can have, as a citizen, political opinion. In attacking me, they suggested that when I was abroad, I spoke out against injustices to the Negro people in the United States. I certainly did.
I have never separated my work as an artist from my work as a human being. To me, my art is always a weapon.
There's a group of young boys here yelling at the people. If there's a serious outbreak, it will be very bad.
And the Supreme Court justice just ruled in the segregation cases that world opinion had a lot to do with our children. Negro children can go to school like anybody else in the South. I'm very proud to have been a part of directing world opinion to precisely that condition.
My personal sacrifices mean very little in the struggle. What does not giving a few concerts mean if you can make some other contribution? I think that the Negro people have to be extremely militant and demand a little more than they are demanding today. I have great faith that somewhere we will realize the democratic potentials of our society. I deeply believe that.
Great. Teaching must be good for you. And Ellen here looks like $1 million. Say, that reminds me, I came laden with gifts. Oh, nice block, Wally. These are just a few flowering weeds.
Oh, thank you, Joe. They're lovely. Tommy, will you call Cleota?
Oh, sure. Cleota! Cleota!
It's fun getting flowers. Very festive.
It's nothing much, but I just wanted you to know that I remember...
Want to persuade people that you love them so much that they ought to love you back.
Don't miss the 80th anniversary of Citizen Kane returning to cinemas for a limited engagement.
Rosebud.
Featuring exclusive insights from Ben Mankiewicz. For more information, go to fathomevents.com.
When we're together, it just feels like we're part of something. I love working with these guys. The idea now that there's five of us, I think the spirit of classic films, the future of classic films is in good hands. I think Robert Osborne would approve, I really do.
The silent picture people had a very hard job. Emotion without words. They came through with flying colors.
For me, silent film reaches a kind of dream state. It has a quality somewhere between what we know as our everyday experience as contemporary sentient beings and sort of these archetypes of characters and conflicts that we understand through mythology.
Silent movies matter so much today, but just because there's sort of this stigma about, ooh, I'm not sure if I want to watch that, it's sort of daunting sometimes, but it's an irrational fear.
What's fascinating about silent film, it records a part of our culture that existed actually during a relatively short window of time from 100 years ago.
the best of the silent films are great works of art. They are the value of a time machine in showing you exactly what people look like, what the streets look like, how they behave to each other, and attitudes.
There's something about being able to see people move in space and in relation to each other and interact with their environment and the way that they wear their clothes, the way people walk. Chaplin's Modern Times gets at this, the mechanized life that millions of people were living during this period.
The crowd has an amazing opening montage of New York, which shows New York in 1928, pre the Empire State Building, which is a New York we don't always think about. Perfectly shows this city in a historic moment in time that is now gone.
Adults kept saying, oh, stay away from silence. They're so badly made, and the photography is awful. And as for the acting, you just laugh at it. And they were so wrong.
There's also sort of this misconception that before Tagus came in, everything was sped up, blurry. You can't understand it. It's sort of this outdated medium, like a cave painting, far from it.
In fact, there's something about those constraints that actually forces artists during that period to be open and creative in the ways that they approach storytelling. There's a specific aesthetic that those filmmakers were developing, and some of them did so in really remarkable ways. Silent film performance, there's a spectrum of types of performance. There's certainly dramatic performance, conveying emotion and not having the capacity to use one's voice means that you have to go to a different set of tools, gesture and facial expression. I love Greta Garbo. She is a genius when it comes to the use of her face and understanding where the camera is and how the lighting is working. She's a figure that really helps us to understand, especially where female performers are concerned, that actors are not simply objects that the directors are kind of molding, but instead they are co-creators of their image. There's that remarkable scene in Flesh and the Devil where she's seducing John Gilbert in the garden, and just every movement of her eyelashes and her mouth and the way she's lit is so carefully crafted.
The eyes can say way more than words, and when you don't have words, the eyes hold it all, and that can go right to the soul. And I feel like a lot of talkies, even films now, they miss that very important element, but the silent films mastered almost every time.
Comic performers, people like Chaplin or Buster Keaton, they're taking incredible risks.
If I was gonna show or introduce silent films to a friend of mine, I'd probably show Safety Last. It's just as funny and frightening as it was back then, but people have such low expectations most of the time for some of these films, they don't expect to be moved the way they are.
The Buster Keaton films are spectacular, and that was just a master at work. I remember seeing one week in particular in which the newlyweds' house is spinning around and around. And there was a kid who was in the front row, and he started laughing. And he started laughing so hard and so hysterically that everyone started looking at the kid who was really just engaged with the film. It had hit him at such a visceral level. It was such an inspiring vision.
F.W. Murnau's film Sunrise, it's a spectacular film in so many ways. And I think it breaks a lot of our assumptions about what silent filmmaking is about. There are very few intertitles in that film. The story, the acting, really carries the film. Extended sequences.
Murnau, King Vidor, they were doing for the eyes what Beatles were doing in the 60s for the ears. Totally just like, how did they do that? And it's just extraordinarily beautiful.
King Vidor was the first silent film director I ever met. He was very self-deprecating, but tremendous confidence. He said, I didn't say much as a director, and I had John Gilbert in front of me, and all I had to do was think it. It was like a love affair, he said.
Seeing a film that was premiered 100 years ago, that is a mind-boggling experience, and a beautiful one.
There is a sense that you're communicating with another time, and in some ways, a lost time, a time that is no longer available to us.
Silent movies are the origins of filmmaking. If you want to understand rock and roll, you have to understand the blues. What really captivates people still is strong story and sympathetic characters. And all of those things are visible in silent films.
You said you were hungry, now you eat. It's gonna be a long night.
People often ask, how do I select the films shown on Noir Alley? And rest assured, I put a lot of thought into curating a tasteful menu of titles.
Makes me hungry.
As a discerning gourmand, I'm looking for the right balance of salt, fat, acid, and of course, heat. I encourage you to expand your palate by sampling international fare.
Oh. Oh, what?
Of course, we won't ignore the meat and potatoes.
I don't like to make love on an empty stomach.
No, neither do I.
Round it out with a deliciously lethal finish, and there you have it. The quintessential noir dish.
Here's a question of whether one who wants to sing and act can have, as a citizen, political opinion. In attacking me, they suggested that when I was abroad, I spoke out against injustices to the Negro people in the United States. I certainly did.
I have never separated my work as an artist from my work as a human being. To me, my art is always a weapon.
There's a group of young boys here yelling at the people. If there's a serious outbreak, it will be very bad.
And the Supreme Court justice just ruled in the segregation cases that world opinion had a lot to do with our children. Negro children can go to school like anybody else in the South. I'm very proud to have been a part of directing world opinion to precisely that condition.
My personal sacrifices mean very little in the struggle. What does not giving a few concerts mean if you can make some other contribution? I think that the Negro people have to be extremely militant and demand a little more than they are demanding today. I have great faith that somewhere we will realize the democratic potentials of our society. I deeply believe that.
This is a good one. Not who your favorite director is. Who's the first director you were aware of?
It was Hitchcock for me. A friend of mine gave me that Hitchcock Truffaut book, yes. The interview book.
Yeah,
that was the first film book I ever had.
Is that right?
It was, yeah. Was that book, yeah.
That's the first one I owned.
Yeah, I mean, that's like a hugely influential book. And I remember when I was a school kid, like in elementary school, it was a big deal when a Hitchcock movie would be on TV. Like, even kids knew, like, The Birds. Mm. They're showing The Birds on TV tonight. And, like, everybody would watch The Birds and then talk about it the next day in school.
Well, speaking about connecting to your parents, my dad pulled me out of bed when I was really young, sat me down and said, I'm going to show you Rear Window and tell you all about Alfred Hitchcock. And so from there, I became a huge nerd, no surprise, and started reading all the books about other directors.
It's very cool to hear the both of you say Hitchcock because it's the same for me as well.
Oh, come on.
And it was the mix of watching old movies on television when I was a kid, and every once in a while a Hitchcock film was on, and I knew right away that's another Hitchcock movie.
Yeah.
I mean, there was something, exactly, there was something about a stylistic through line across the films, no matter who the actors were. It could be Jimmy Stewart, it could be Cary Grant, it could be Laurence Olivier, but you knew that there was this author behind it, and that was a really powerful thing,
right,
too.
Right. Dave?
I would say John Hughes, because I was 12, 13 years old in the mid-1980s, and I discovered movies like 16 Candles and The Breakfast Club, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, and I really realized that one man could have such an impact writing and directing a film.
So the first director that I became aware of the art of directing, and it came late in my life, I was in college, really, would have been Martin Brest. I still remember the feeling of when I saw Midnight Run and thinking, as I later thought when I saw Out of Sight, man, if movies made me feel like this, I would make sure I went to a movie every night. You cannot get a better feeling than this. And I thought, it's so funny, it's so perfect, it's put together so well, right? Mm-hmm. George Gallo wrote it, but clearly, you know, Marty Brest created this magical movie for him.
A couple of good actors there, too.
Grodin and De Niro, they helped. Yaphet Kotto, they definitely. He probably didn't think he'd come up in this conversation.
He pulled that one out.
All morning, but you go down to that restaurant and work, just like you've been sleeping all night, only you ain't.
Keeps me thin.
Beg pardon? Don't do nothing for me.
With an unmistakable name and a voice to match, Butterfly McQueen was a character actress who brought levity and laughs to her performances.
Uh-oh, here it comes.
I'm busy!
No, back!
No!
Born Thelma McQueen in 1911, she earned the nickname Butterfly after performing the Butterfly Ballet in an off-Broadway production of A Midsummer Night's Dream in 1935. Butterfly's passion for dance and theater, along with her distinctive voice, led her to be discovered and offered her most famous film role, that of Prissy, in the 1939 film Gone with the Wind.
Mammy, here's the scarlet pickles.
You can take it all back to the kitchen. I won't need a bite.
Her performance in this epic movie led to one of the most famous lines in film history.
Oh, Lossy, Miss Scarlet!
What is it?
Lossy, we've got to have a doctor. I don't know nothing about birthing babies.
It was an amazing career opportunity, but playing the part of Prissy was not an easy choice for the actress. Butterfly felt her part as written was demeaning. Standing up for herself, she refused to allow Vivian Leigh to deliver a real slap to her face. Despite her efforts, McQueen was held in contempt by some who felt her portrayal did nothing but perpetuate negative black stereotypes.
You're as slow as molasses in January. And where's Dr. Meade?
I've never seen him, Miss Scarlet.
What?
No, he ain't at the hospital.
Despite all of this, McQueen later expressed gratitude for the part of Prissy, realizing the historical significance of both Gone with the Wind and her part in black film history.
I said $2.
While on hiatus from filming Gone with the Wind, McQueen was offered a part in George Cukor's film, The Women, delivering a dish of sassy banter with Joan Crawford.
Was you asking for me, Miss Allen?
Been scouring the whole store for you. Why don't you run to my apartment and cook dinner?
I've got a date tonight, Miss Crystal.
Oh, you can break it. Come on.
But I'm noted for the bad way I cook.
If you throw a lamb chop into a hot oven, what's going to keep it from getting done?
Although Butterfly only appeared in one scene, she would join Crawford again 6 years later in the film Mildred Pierce in a more substantial role.
Where did you get that uniform?
Miss Vita gave it to me. She makes me wear it in case I have to answer the doorbell.
Miss Vita gave it to you?
I told her you wouldn't like it, Mrs. Pierce. I told her right off.
The 1940s saw the height of Butterfly McQueen's film career.
Flaxon says she sees you naturally in a little while.
Oh. May I use your telephone?
Huh? Oh, that thing. You twist the handle once and someone says, this is the bar.
But the lack of meaningful roles available to her meant she was destined to play mostly maids and housekeepers. Film historian and author Donald Bogle said of Butterfly McQueen that her talents were often misused or misunderstood by directors and writers. This was certainly the case in 1941's Affectionately Yours, which had McQueen delivering embarrassingly worn-out dialogue.
Who dat?
Who dat say who dat?
Who dat say who dat when I say who dat?
The few exceptions to these roles included films with all-black casts, like 1948's Killer Diller and 1943's Cabin in the Sky.
You're just joining up, Lily.
That's nice. Wasn't a minute too soon, neither.
But the scarcity of available parts beyond domestics discouraged McQueen, so much so that she left Hollywood. McQueen had said, I didn't mind playing a maid the first time because I thought that was how you got into the business. But after I did the same thing over and over, I resented it. I didn't mind being funny, but I didn't like being stupid. With just 12 film appearances and several television credits to her name, Butterfly spent her later years living in relative anonymity. She worked odd jobs, earned a degree from City College in New York at the age of 64, and dedicated herself to social work projects in her Harlem community.
I knows how to do it.
Although often marginalized during her film career, McQueen will be remembered for her pioneering spirit and her passion for entertaining as one of the few black women in the classic Hollywood studio era. She was a true trailblazer, paving the way for those who followed. Butterfly McQueen, what a character.
The good, the bad, the ugly. The blue, the gray. The Civil War. Questions. the answers. The showdown. The goal.
Want to persuade people that you love them so much that they ought to love you back.
Don't miss the 80th anniversary of Citizen Kane returning to cinemas for a limited engagement.
Rosebud.
Featuring exclusive insights from Ben Mankiewicz. For more information, go to fathomevents.com.
Looking to jazz up movie night? The TCM Wine Club hits all the right notes. Enjoy premium wines from around the world delivered straight to your door. From Eartha Kitt to a trip to the moon, the TCM Wine Club takes you on a voyage of discovery, sourcing spectacular domestic and international wines. Every case is expertly curated with informative tasting notes and recommended pairings with great classic movies seen on TCM. As part of a special welcome offer, you'll receive 15 delicious wines, including 3 exclusive movie-themed wines for an incredible value. Your satisfaction is guaranteed. Now celebrating its 5th anniversary, the TCM Wine Club delivers memorable sips and swing to your movie routine. Visit tcmwineclub.com or call 1-844-WINE-TCM.
There were usually brilliant performances in a Kazan movie, and then every once in a while, just on the fringes of the story, little characters would come in, and I wondered why that was. So I went around to some of the actors who had worked with Kazan and asked them, how does Kazan work? Well, Gadge was his nickname. Gadge will always be watching you when you're least aware that anyone is watching you. If he finds a particular idiosyncrasy that you may have, either a gesture or the way of looking at something or the way, he will find a way to use that in the character. There was a particular time in Piggott, and we were out in a dusty field, and I was up on a stage, and I was with Lonesome Rose and Andy Griffith, and I was watching, and I was the publicity guy, and Lee Remick was down there doing, twirling her baton. And Gadge is walking away, and I see him looking at me, just fanning myself, and I hear Gadge say, okay, bring the camera back, Tony, stay right there. So the camera was brought back, and he said, just do what you're doing. Just relax and just fan yourself. So I did that. And he said, now look over where Lonesome Roads is. And I look over there. He said, now look over to where Lee is. And I looked over there. And he said, now think about the fact that maybe they can get together. So I said, uh-huh. So that was a scene that in which I felt that I used Gadge's observation as a director. And it worked. It worked very well. It was used in the film.
When we're together, it just feels like we're part of something. I love working with these guys.
We like to play that there's a little Ben and Eddie feud.
Which one is Eddie? I love messing with Eddie. I love messing with him on Twitter. But, you know, there's hardly a person I respect more.
He will tell you all these fascinating tales about obscure film noirs that then I write down so I make sure I see it after I talk to him.
We're so lucky to have Alicia. She just has this bursting wealth of knowledge, and it just seems to come from this place of joy.
This is something that she's been studying her entire life, so to see her on TCM is just really exciting for me.
Dave Karger. He is someone who so clearly connects the history of Hollywood film from the classic era to the present.
Jacqueline Stewart is the film professor I wish I had in college.
A lot of people with TCM know movies. I think she may win. I think the spirit of classic films, the future of classic films is in good hands.